This is not a sponsored video. If it were, you'd probably be looking at the Elgato Key Light right about now. It's very bright, has a wide color temperature range, and can be controlled with an app. It also costs $200 American. Each. This light is not as bright, nor does it have Wi-Fi or play dubstep every time you get a new Twitch subscriber. What it is the Nanlite LumaPad 11. Portable, adjustable, professional quality lighting made accessible to everyone. And I'm going to show you how to use one or two of these lights to take the best scale model and toy photos you've ever made. In the world of digital photography, lighting is data. The more light you have, the better the computer with the fancy glass eyeball on the front is at determining what your image is supposed to be. For more on that subject, check out my old but still relevant video on basic photo lighting with desk lamps, and the one that explains all those buttons and knobs and what they mean on your dad's DSLR he used once and forgot about after that midlife crisis trip to Moab in the family's Jeep Liberty 3 years ago. So what does the Nanlite LumaPad 11 do to help your camera take a good photo? The LumaPad 11 outputs 969 nice lumens of brightness, and features adjustable color temperature from 3200 to 5600 degrees Kelvin, more than enough for any real-world natural lighting application. For comparison, the Yanzio desk lamps shown in my basic lighting video output between 220 and 400 lumens at 3000 degrees Kelvin, producing a warm white color tone. The lower the light temperature, the warmer the color, as counterintuitive as that may sound. It's also considerably smaller than the Key Light and many of its counterparts in the professional lighting industry. For those of us shooting photos of scale models and other plastic toys, a small form factor is a major advantage, as larger lights can be harder to control at a small scale, flooding the room with lighting as eye-catching as a tax office break room. The LumaPad 11 and its bigger brother, the LumaPad 25, also support both standard AC and battery power, making them infinitely more portable and perfect for location shoots. And I haven't even got to the best part yet. The Nanlite LumaPad 11 costs $49.99, a quarter of the price of the Key Light and dramatically lower than most any other reputable professional light in its class. Now, why am I gushing over this light you've probably never heard of and comparing it to the streamer equivalent of a designer brick? Simple, because they run my stream. Three of them, in fact, giving me infinite lighting options and easy adjustability for the changing lighting conditions in the house what I have throughout the course of a broadcast. And while you can buy four Yanzio lamps from IKEA for the same price as one LumaPad 11, if you're looking to take your photo lighting a little more seriously, Nanlite's pint-sized workhorse stands unmatched. My only real complaint is that you can't really just pull them out of the box and start blowing away your 10 Twitter followers with mind-melting photographic wonderment. You will need to supply your own power. Thankfully, AC adapters are like a dime a dozen at your local thrift store. But in case you're watching this while there's still an actual plague going on, I've included a link to some down in the description below. Ideally, you will want to mount these lights on stands also, so I've included a link to a fine budget option down there also. Anything that has a standard tripod mounting screw will work just fine, so feel free to shop around for even cheaper options than these. So you've got your lights, you've got power, and in a bit, you'll have a bunch of portrait lighting techniques adapted for tiny children's toys. But what about your subject? Well, since I was able to rent out some fancy photography studio I used for my Perfect Grade Exia video from 2.5 years ago, seriously, I wanted to use a kit that's equally fancy for this advanced lighting crash course. The high-resolution Gundam Astray Red Frame. A very pretty pseudo-kit that confuses me in every possible way. More on that another time, though. Let's play with some lights! Right, quick bit of housekeeping. Everything you see going forward, as with my previous lighting tutorial, is shot with the built-in camera app on my phone. In this case, an iPhone 11 Pro. The only adjustments to the shot are being made within the camera, and only prior to the shot being taken. No editing after the fact. Finally, the lights are running at 100% brightness and at 4,000 degrees Kelvin, unless otherwise noted. First up is a technique known as butterfly lighting, for reasons which, if I'm completely honest, aren't entirely clear. We'll position our single light slightly to the left of our camera's position. It might look like it's far off to the side here, but we're going to have our camera right about here for all of our shots. This gives us more dramatic shadows across the face of the Astray, accentuated by the gigantic V-fin. The position of the lights also highlights the gold sword accents on its waist, as well as its excellent cherry blossom decal it comes with on its shoulder armor. By moving the light closer and tilting it down, we get a much more aggressive look with higher contrast. But take a look at the background. Because the light is no longer bouncing directly off our background, we now have a kit that dominates the frame, with the darkest blacks still separated from the dark gray in the background. With those intense shadows, however, we begin to lose some detail accents in the faceplate and neck on the parts of the kit facing away from the light. This is where light reflection comes in. By placing a white matte surface underneath your subject, you can bounce a small portion of the extra light not hitting the kit back onto the darker areas. You might not want to use this huge diffusion flag I'm using here, though. A simple sheet of printer paper will work just fine at our scale. Next up, loop lighting. This is commonly used for headshots used by professional actor types, and probably for those high school senior photos you try not to think about. If we start with butterfly lighting, we simply shift the light a little lower, right about at eye level with the kit, and further to the side. At our scale, this accentuates the parts of the kit closest to the camera, as well as keeping the high contrast dark areas of your more aggressive butterfly lighting. It also brightens your backdrop if it's fairly close to your subject, making it a solid choice for larger dioramas. Rembrandt lighting takes butterfly and loop lighting to its logical conclusion, and also makes you sound like you know what you're talking about as a pretentious art student without all the crippling debt. On human faces, the placement of Rembrandt lighting creates a triangle of light on the subject's farmost cheek, making them appear more moody and edgy. You'll bring your light back up to about the same level as your butterfly light setup, then move it even further to the same angle as your loop light setup. On model kits, this does a couple things. We preserve the same harsh shadows as before, but we also accentuate the V-fin of the Astray here far greater than we have with our previous shots. Look at how the V-fin is compared to that of the previous shots. Notice how the light source is reflecting off the edge of the left V-fin in a way that we didn't have in either butterfly or loop lighting scenarios. Rembrandt, for as pretentious as it sounds, might be the gold standard for dramatic lighting effects for plastic model kits. Speaking of pretentious, let's give your kit a smug aura that mocks anyone that scrolls by your Instagram with rim lighting. This technique is particularly challenging with scale models, as the technique works best on human-sized subjects. That said, Small, bright lights like the Yanzio desk lamp we mentioned earlier can pull this off well at scale model size. The LumaPad 11 can also, but only to an extent. For this technique, we place the light directly behind the kit, and lower it to the point where the light is shooting upwards at the subject like an ill-proportioned spotlight. At this scale, and with this big of a light proportionally, we don't get the same thin veins of light accenting the edges of the kit that we would expect with other shots with this same technique, but we do get some other interesting effects. Most notably, the V-fin lighting up like glowing horns, and a bit of diffusion around the edges of the rear armor. A lot of the detail on the kit, however, flattens out, so unless you're going for a highly stylized look on darker kits, this might not be the best call. In my opinion, rim light on model kits works best with an additional fill. If you have two lights, you can place a second light behind your camera pointing down to fill in some of the details. I set my second light to 25% brightness here to give more life to the center of the shot, while still preserving the glowing horns and dramatic light points from behind the kit that we saw earlier. Broad lighting is basically butterfly or loop lighting in reverse. The light position complements the closest part of the subject respective to the placement of the camera, and devoids the backdrop of almost any light. While this can be amazing for custom builds where you want to show off every detail, for stock builds like this Astray, it really accents how plasticky everything is. Save this for those customs you want to use to farm upvotes on Dig or whatever. Finally, a personal favorite of mine, clamshell lighting. You will need two lights for this, but the effect makes your subject look battle-ready in a very, very unique way. We'll place one light directly above the subject facing down, then a second light firing from below. By doing this, we're getting an ignition sequence look that makes the Astray look like it's ready to launch from a feudal period catapult deck. We're able to accent the head and V-fin as well as the legs and sword to create a unique effect that also devoids the background of much of your light source. Try it with a panel-lined kit and watch the lines pop even harder. Another thing to note with clamshell lighting is how much cooler in color the shot turned out. When using automatic camera settings, as we've done in this entire tutorial, the inclusion of an additional light source this close to the frame forces more light to bounce off the white areas of the subject and back into the camera's sensor. Because lighting is data, the camera sensor is now receiving more information about the white areas of the kit, causing the automatic color correction to bias more towards a cool white rather than the warmer reds. I could probably rattle off a couple dozen more of these before this video is over, but I don't want to bore you to death, so give these a try and post up some of your favorites in the Bad Gunpla Discord. You don't need a professional studio to have professional lighting. I just happened to rent one. You could just as easily wait for nightfall, clear a spot on your floor, and set up some trifold poster board to shoot your kits with tremendous new lighting. Nothing says that you're proud of your work like a good photo. Too many great builds, customs, and dioramas are all done a disservice with badly lit photos. I do hope that these techniques give you some ideas for how to make your Bad Gunpla stand out. Just remember that you'll need to turn the lights off with a switch rather than an app, like a normal person. See you next time.